Hi all, and welcome to a new class of Principle of Macroeconomics. Today, we are gonna cover our first chapter, the 10 Principle of Economics. Let's get started. The word economics comes from the Greek word oikonomia, which means the management of the household. Indeed, economics is the science that studies how to manage the scarce resources that are available. And macroeconomics studies the allocation and management of the resources of the economy as a whole. So, scarcity plays a very important role in economics. If resources were not scarce, then we wouldn't need economics. Let us review the 10 principles of economics. The principles of economics are organized in three main categories. In particular, how people make decisions, how people interact within each other, and how the economy works as a whole. Let's start with the first category. The first four principles of economics are about how people make decisions. And in particular, we are going to introduce some very useful concepts like the one of trade-off, the one of opportunity cost, the one, basically the assumption that we make about how people make decisions, that makes rational decisions. And finally, we're going to look at the fact that people respond to incentives. Let us start from the first principle of economics, which is people face trade-off. Now, what does it mean, the fact that people face trade-off? Well, since resources are scarce, if we want something, often we have to give up something else. So the concept of trade-off is intimately related with the concept of scarcity. If resources were not scarce, then eventually we wouldn't face trade-off. An example of a scarce resource that we are going to use actually during this class is the concept of time. Time, if you want, is a proverbial example of a scarce resource. We have arrived to the first bifurcation. Now, this is a very good example of a trade-off. Indeed, if I choose to go left, then I'm not going right. And if I choose to go right, I'm not going left. Imagine what is the scarce resource which is behind this trade-off. Think about this for a second. Pause the video and think about this for a second. Well, the scarce resource behind the decision going left and right is time. If I choose to go left, I'm gonna spend my time going left, but at the same time, I cannot use this time to go right. I am facing now this trade-off. Should I go left or should I go right? Now, how am I going to make this assessment? Now, in order to choose whether to go left and right, I had to introduce a new concept, the concept of opportunity cost, which is the second principle of economics. So the opportunity cost is telling us that the cost of something, say the cost of going left, is what you give up in order to get it. So we can use this concept of opportunity cost in order to inform our decision, whether to go left or whether to go right. Now, if I go left, I obtain some net benefit. So say the benefit is a marvelous view, but there is some effort to get there. So it's this view minus the effort cost of getting there. But the opportunity cost is telling us that in order to decide whether to go left or right, this is not sufficient. I do not have only to consider the cost or the effort of going left, but also to consider the fact that if I go left, I'm renouncing to go right. And going right has some net benefits. The net benefit of going right is that I'm gonna see maybe an even nicer view, but I had to pay an effort to get there. So how do I choose whether to go left or right? Well, I had to compare which one gives me the higher net benefit. If there is a very high net benefit of going right, then I would choose to go right. If there is a very high net benefit of going left, I will choose to go left. So the opportunity cost is telling us that when we choose whether to go left or right, not only we have to subtract, if you want, the cost of, you know, the view that you get by getting left or right, but also the net benefit that you get by taking the other road. Now, not only individual face trade-off, also society as a whole face trade-off. Now, a very important trade-off is the one between efficiency and equity. Now, efficiency is basically about when society gets the most out of their scarce resources. So efficiency is really about making the size of the pie, of the social pie, as big as possible. While equity is basically studies, or if you want, is about how this pie is split among the agents. You can think that we can make the pie bigger, but maybe split in a fair way. And actually, this represents a very important trade-off. We will see that prices are a very good mechanism in order to make the pie bigger, so in order to allocate the scarce resources, but they're not very good at splitting the pie. And this is something that we will return in later chapters during this course. Wonderful. We have arrived to the second bifurcation. And it's a good time now to introduce another very useful principle, which is the third principle of economics, which is the fact that rational people think at the margin. In particular, we are going to use this principle in order to decide whether we want to go left or whether we want to go right. Now, in order to inform this decision, as we have seen before, we're going to use the concept of opportunity cost. In particular, we are going to compare the net benefits of going left with the net benefits of going right. The concept of opportunity cost is telling us that if I choose to go left, it's because the benefits of the view are higher than the cost of getting there, minus the net benefits of going to the right, which is the benefits of the view minus the cost of getting there. Now, the third principle of economics, which is about rational people think at the margin, introduce, if you want, something else, which is, when I have to take the decision of going left or right, do I have to take into account all the road that I basically make in order to get here? So do I have to consider the fact, you know, all the efforts that I did to get here in order to inform my decision whether to go left or right? Pause the video for a second and try to think about it. Now, the third principle of economics, which says rational people think at the margin, is telling us that the only thing that I had to compare is the marginal benefits of going left versus the marginal cost, which is the marginal cost is the effort minus, if you want, the marginal net benefit of going to the right using the opportunity cost. So if you want, all the road that we did in order to get here do not affect directly our decision of going left or going right, but it will indirectly affect it just by increasing, if you want, our cost. As instance, if you have been working for 2 hours, you know, we are tired, so our cost would be higher. But that's the only way in which the road that we did, it's going to affect our decision. For the rest, it's sunk. It's a sunk cost. So it's not going to inform our decision of going left or right. Well, let me go right. It seems easier. So I decided to go right. And my choice was based on the fact that I said, it seems easier. Why? Because I don't really know this trail. So I do not know what is the net benefit of going on the left, the net benefit of going on the right. But this is something that, again, is intimately related with the fact that rational people think at the margin, which also implies that people do the best they can. What does it mean that people do the best they can? Well, people use all the available information in order to take the best decision. Now, in this case, there was not really information that I had available in order to inform this decision. So basically, I just had a look on the left and right, and I decided that the right seemed easier, so seemed best for how it fit to me today. Okay? But you can think about applying these principles when you invest assistance in the stock market. In the stock market, players use all the information they have in order to take their investment decision. This is at least what we hope. Now, a question I want to ask you is, do you think that people are rational? Do you actually think that people use all their available information in order to inform their decision? Well, that is not always the case. Let's look at this example. So our question is, are people rational? Now, what I'm reporting here is the results of Google Trends about what were the top questions on the European Union in the UK since the Brexit results. And as you can see, forget about the first question. First question is, what does it mean to leave the European Union? So what are the consequences of Brexit? Now, notice the second top UK question on the European Union, which is, what is the European Union? So these Google Trends results are suggestive of the fact that many people voted for Brexit in the United Kingdom without even knowing what was the European Union. I'll let you form your opinion about that. Let us now conclude our first category of principle economics on how people make decisions with the last principle, which is people respond to incentives. So people respond to reward and punishment. Assistance, take assistance, you know, this hike that I've been doing this morning. Well, I do not have many incentives to keep going up because there is really, I want to go back to work actually now. But of course, if you're telling me that on the top there is a buffet with caviar and etc., oh, that will change my decision. So this is a principle that actually we are going to use over and over and over in economics, which is basically, if the government or any policymaker changes a situation in the economics that alter the incentives of the people, say you tax capital, or you decide assistance, say you tax capital, then eventually this will affect the decision of the individuals. Say if you decide to tax capital, individual will save less. Or assistance if you increase the price of cigarettes, well, people will smoke less. If you tax the gasoline, then there's gonna be a boom in electric car, and so on and so forth. So this is a very important principle that you have to take into account when one day you will become the government, the governor of Colorado or some state in the United States. When you interfere with the economic system, so when you basically decide to impose some policy, that will have a reaction in the way in which agents will behave. And you have to take account of this if you want feedback reaction in order to inform your policy decision. Let us move to the next category of principle of economics. Now, the next category has to do on how people interact within each other. And there are three principles that fall in this category. The first one, trade can make everyone better off. The second one, markets are usually a good way to organize economic activity. And the third one, that the government can improve on market outcomes in presence of some form of market failure. Let us look at them in turn. Trade can make everyone better off. Now, we are going to learn in chapter 3 that if countries specialize in the production of goods on which they have a comparative advantage, then they can make the social pie for both countries bigger. What does it mean if countries like China specialize in manufacturing, countries like Italy specialize in, I don't know, in fashion goods, and countries like the United States specialize in technology? Then we would have better quality goods or higher quantity at cheaper prices. This means basically that by specialize on the goods on which countries have a comparative advantage, we can make the social pie bigger. Yet, as you can see in the name of the principle, in the statement of the principle, trade can, in principle, make everyone better off. And this, if you want, this the can part of the principle informs us that maybe the social benefits of trade are not split equally. So this is something that we are going to learn in chapter 9. And in particular, we are going to learn in chapter 9 that although trade can make in principle everyone better off, the way in which these social benefits of trades are split among the agents may actually be not completely equal. Therefore, although the pie is bigger, there might be some player that get a smaller slice. So principle 6 tells us that markets are usually a good way in order to organize economic activity. And in particular, what does that mean is that actually the price system is an efficient way of allocating resources. What does it mean? Prices are very useful in order to determine what goods had to be produced, which type of technology, how much of these goods had to be produced, and who gets these goods. So prices are very good in allocating resources. So prices, if you want, are very good in making the social pie bigger. But prices also at the same time plays another role. So they play the role of allocating resources, but also play another role, which is the one of splitting the social surplus. And in this sense, prices are actually not maybe a good way of splitting the surplus. So going back to our, basically when we discussed the fact that society faced trade-off, prices are very good in making the social pie bigger, but they are not very good at splitting the social pie. So although existence by trade we can make, if you want, everyone better off, someone gets a smaller slice of this. And this is because prices are not very good in the splitting of the pie. We can move now to principle number 7. Which says that government can sometimes improve economic outcomes. So market might fail in the moment in which the price system fail. So market might fail in the moment in which prices are not efficient in allocating their resources. And this can happen really in presence of two circumstances: externalities and market power. Let's look at them in turn. Now, externalities have to do with the fact that maybe the price does not embed all the social costs. What does it mean? Embeds only private costs, but not the cost for the society. Let us make an example. Think about a firm that uses a technology that might pollute a river. Now, if the firm does not internalize the fact that by producing the goods and using that type of technology, it pollutes the river and therefore creates a cost for the society, And if the firm just consider its private cost, which is, you know, say the cost of the particular fuel that is using to produce the good, then eventually it's going to produce more of that good and therefore polluting more the river. So the price in that case of that good is going to be lower than the one that it should be socially optimal. So that particular price does not take into account that that good actually is creating, say, some damage to other agents in the economy. I mean, a typical example is basically smoking. If I smoke a cigarette, I pay, you know, the price for the cigarette. I am smoking the cigarette, but at the same time, the smoke is gonna make, you know, the air polluted, and then people around me might find this one unpleasant. So this is an example of the market failure. Basically, what you would like is the price of the cigarette to internalize the fact that by smoking, I am actually polluting the air of people around me that would likely to charge me for that. So the price of the cigarette should be higher. And the second, basically, again, prices are in principle a good way of allocating resources, but sometimes they fail. A second reason why they fail is market power. If a firm has monopoly power, and in presence of asymmetric information, this is something maybe we will touch later, what do I mean by this asymmetric information? But if a firm has market power, basically can charge a price that is higher than the cost that this firm is facing, the opportunity cost of facing to produce a particular good. So if you want this, the price will not be good in order to tell us how scarce is that particular resource. Because of this reason, the government can sometimes improve over market outcomes. In addition, as we mentioned before, society faces a trade-off. It's not only about making the pie as big as possible, so it's not only about efficiency, but it's also about equality. So the market, the government can actually sometimes improve over market outcomes by promoting equality, so promoting access to equal opportunities. And last but not least, we need a government in general for the enforcement of the law. And the enforcement, of contracts. Now, in an economy where contracts are nil, where people basically do not need to abide to the contracts, then eventually transaction will be difficult. So having a very good legal system might actually improve economic outcomes. The last category of principle of economics describes how the economy works as a whole, provides some principle about how the economy works as a whole. Principle number 8 says that the standards of living of a country, so you can think about life expectancy or the child mortality, these are intimately related to the basically productivity of a particular country. So the ability of a country of having more goods per person. And we are going to discuss this one at length in chapter 12. Then eventually in later chapters, we are going to learn, in particular in chapter 16 and 17, that basically inflation is a monetary phenomenon that is due to the fact that the government prints too much money. So if the government prints too much money, there is not a real impact in the economy in the long run, but it only affects the level of prices. So if the Federal Reserve now prints a lot of money to get out of this COVID recession, that is in principle good in the short run, but in the long run it will just result with a higher level of prices. And this is something that we are going to learn in chapter 16 and 17, which are really fascinating chapters. Now, money is a good that you have not seen yet in microeconomics, and the theory of money is actually decoupled, or well, it's not decoupled, but is a different theory with respect to the theory of value that you have seen in microeconomics. Last but not least, we are gonna look at the last principle of economics, which is basically the fact that the society faces a short-run trade-off between inflation and unemployment. And this is gonna be in later chapter, in particular in chapter 21. And the intuition is that basically, in principle, in the short run, the government, in particular the Federal Reserve, could actually exploit the ability of printing money in order to reduce unemployment. What does that mean by printing money? Basically, it can reduce the number of unemployed people. But something that we learn is that this trade-off is a very short-run trade-off, which means that in the long run, if the government keeps printing money, well, you don't get lower unemployment, you just get a higher inflation. And the intuition behind that is really you can think about as with a diet. If you reduce the number of calories in your organism, then at the beginning you can get, you know, a decrease in your weight. But if you do it in a stable way, in which you, I don't know, you pass from 2,000 calories per day to 1,500 calories per day, then the organism starts understanding that. The organism starts to adapt. The organism starts basically... The organism starts basically to run on lower calories. And therefore, at that point, there is, you know, you basically go to a new steady state, a new equilibrium, in which the organism runs with less calories. Same thing basically with the money. If you keep printing money, at the beginning, in the short run, you get a reduction in unemployment, but after a while, the economy starts understanding, the agents start to understand that we just have more money going around, more, if you want, fancy coupons, cold money going around, we are gonna get into the theory of money. That's crazy. But so we have more of this, you know, good going around, but there is not a real, more real goods in the economy. And because of that, basically the agents will adjust their expectation, and this is gonna become just a result only in higher inflation. And that, I think, is it for this chapter. So we are gonna move now to chapter number 2, where we are gonna learn how economists think.